Hi everyone, so in this video we're going to calculate the mean, calculate your standard deviation, and plot the data. So draw a graph, make a visualization of it. So let's get into this video. It's a follow-up from the finding the story in your data. Now let me give a background of the sorts of scenarios where you may want to calculate a mean. Do the standard deviation, go ahead and plot it. So let's say we've got these data sets where we've got experiments where we've done it under different conditions, and we want to compare whether the different conditions we have different outcomes as a result of treating these particular say cells or animals or conditions are different. So you go ahead and say I've got a control set of results. The control set of results, these were absorbances that I read in an analyzer. I went ahead and adjusted for the dilution that I had done during the setup. Then I had three different conditions that varied to the control. So I have condition one, and I have that data set and the average results of the absorbances, well, the concentrations of the absorbances. This is obtained from a standard curve, and if that's not familiar, that can be a future video that I do. But you go ahead and get all the average absorbances and from that get your concentrations based on a standard curve. And I've gone ahead and done it for the three conditions as well as the control condition. So then we need to calculate the average. The average is also referred to as a mean. And the average, the idea of the average is that all of these control samples are treated the same. So rather than have each one stand alone, we can get a value that represents all of them. And the way you do that is to add all the sum all the values together and then divide by the number of values that went into it in the first place. In Excel, there's a simple formula, a simple function. So you can go equals and AV, as you type average will suggest it for you. And if you select it, you'll be able to select all the values that you want to go into that average, and it will just give you an average value for all those values. Then you want to look at the standard deviation. The standard deviation says, okay, so I had in this case seven different readouts that have gone into this average. How much does each of these actually differ from this average that I've calculated? It gives you an idea of variability, the spread of the data. So if each one was doing its own thing, it was very different from the other, you will capture that in the standard deviation. So the standard deviation, this is the formula for standard deviation. But once again, we're working in Excel and there's a function for it. You can go equals, and as you type standard deviation, you get the suggestion. You just need to pick whether it's a population standard deviation or a sample standard deviation. In my case, it's a sample. So go ahead and select that, and I have a standard deviation to represent the variability in my data. So in Excel, you can go ahead and do it for all the other conditions, and that's that. Is as easy as it gets. So we have our average, we have our standard deviation. Now that we have that, we want to plot it. Now these are individual groups. So we have a control, we have condition one, we have condition two, and condition three. There is no connection between them. So in this case, we can use a bar chart. If there was connection between them, so let's say it was different time points where I just had time point one, then time point two, then time point three, then time point four, then I wouldn't use a bar chart. I would use a line graph, which kind of shows you the progression of the absorbance reading in my case, or whatever reporter or analysis final readout you were using. Just track it for you. So in that case, a line graph would be better. But in this case, they are standalone, so I can use a bar chart. So in Excel, you just go ahead and go into insert, and when you go into insert, there's some recommended charts you can pick from. So in my case, you can pick other ones and you get a feel for if it's appropriate or not, but in my case, I know that I want a bar chart, so I'll go ahead and select the bar chart, and here we go, I've got the bar chart right there. Now in this part, we're going to get into the details of the plot of the graph. What are we plotting? How do we want the plot to appear? The bar charts that we're going to do, how do we want it to appear? That's what we're going to focus on in this section. So you've got your standard deviations and you've got your averages. These are what we need to do the plot. The next decision we have to make then is, how do we want the plot to appear? Do we want our different conditions to be grouped together, or do we want them separated? Let me explain. Say we are comparing two reducing agents, TSEP and beta-mercaptoethanol. So those are two different chemicals that we're using in our experiment, reagents that we're using. But we're also testing it on three different tissue sizes to see its capacity to reduce tissue homogenate, to reduce the particular residues that we need to reduce. Now, do we want to separate our visualization based on the TSEP and beta-mercaptoethanol, or do we want to visualize it based on the different time points or the different tissue sizes, that we're using? So that's the decision you have to make when you're making your visualizations. Just look at whether you want, what definitive condition you want to separate the data by. And so in this kind of bar chart, do we want the different tissue homogenate to be the definitive thing where we separate it by, or do we want the reagent to be the focus where we separate the data by? So depending on how we want to present it, it will dictate how we enter the values in Excel. So if we let the reagent be the focus where we group everything by, then you can see that by using the vertical wells, and so this is essentially your columns, you've got condition one, condition two as a column coming down, or you've got reagent one, reagent two, or in specifically in this example, TSEP versus BME, then what you're going to get all your values for TSEP coming close to each other, and then you have a gap, and then all your values for the next condition or next reagent, or specifically for beta-mercaptoethanol in this example, being shown separated from the other reagent or other condition. If you want the classes to be based on your tissue in this example, specifically the different sizes of tissues that went into the homogenate, so I had a 2 millimeter tissue homogenate, a 3 millimeter, and a 6 millimeter, then because I want those to be the clusters, the ones that are close to each other, then I will put those on the column in the cells, in the vertical cells. So whatever is in the cells, in the columns, the vertical cells are the ones that will be separated. And whatever is in the rows will be grouped together, close together to each other. So if you want the gaps to be between the different conditions, then make sure that the different conditions are arranged in your vertical cells, aka your columns. And if you want them to be grouped together, then put them in the rows next to each other, aka the horizontal cells. Knowledge testing time. Based on what we've just learned, do you think that the different conditions, that is the control, the low and the high, do you think they were arranged vertically or horizontally in this particular plot to get them to cluster as they have? Please let me know your answer in the comments. A quick note that by default, when Excel gives you the graphs, the plots, it will put it all in the same color. But for ease of interpretation and visualization, it is recommended that it will make it easier if you put the different conditions in different colors. So just people look at it, they know there's a difference between the plots. And to do that, you can customize by just selecting each of individual chart. Initially, when you click on it, it will select all the charts, but if you click specifically again into the particular bar chart, then you will be able to select the specific color for that particular condition if you know it's all different conditions. A note of caution here, though, is that you don't want to make it super colorful. You probably can also just do like different shades if it's different intensities, or it doesn't have to be like gaudy if you don't want it to be gaudy, but it's just nice to have visual cues that what the person's looking at represents differences. Okay, I'm going to leave this video here. If you are looking for more details on how to beautify your plot, I do have a video that goes into it more in depth. It's called Plot Graph in Excel After Calculating Mean Standard Deviation. It's a much longer video that goes into how to insert axis titles, make your actual chart area, you know, clear lines that just make things look busy, thicken the bars, the lines specifically to make it pop a little more. So if you're looking for those kind of information, then please feel free to refer to that video. I'm gonna leave it here. Thanks for dropping by. God bless you, and I'll catch you in the next one.